Hi, my name is Raviraj and I'm an occupational therapist, and today I will be sharing with you all or inviting you all to think about how as occupational therapists can we respond to the psychosocial impacts COVID-19 is having on all of us and on the people that we work with. And to do this, I'm going to call upon the experience I've had of working in the mental health space since the last few years with communities, children, families, adults, and individuals, and also collaborating with organizations in the last few weeks to think about how do we respond to this situation together, and also to find out what are we dealing with exactly. So let's think about this together in this seminar for the next maybe half an hour, 40 minutes. What is occupation for us is something that we all know that as occupational therapists, we assume that when human beings and communities participate in a meaningful preferred occupation, is how we make sense of ourselves and the world around us, and how that leads to well-being and health. Just to put this into more context of that's how we sort of continue to take care of ourselves and our communities and make sense of the world that we live in is by participating in varied different occupations that are available to us and so that we prefer to do in our lives. But what's unique about the COVID-19 situation? Let's see that. Now we know that participation happens this way, but we also know that in the last few weeks, because of the COVID-19 situation, there has been a quarantine to keep us safe from this. And that has led to many, many people and families and communities to not be able to participate in their occupations at all. For example, for many children, access to school has been in a complete lockdown. And something that they preferred to do, something that they enjoyed to do, something that was their social space, has been now not accessible to them anymore. For some, it's different because we had to find out new complicated ways to participate in the occupation. Initially, it was simple. Now it's become more complicated, more newer ways to find this out. For example, let's take the example of school again. Like for many children, now school has become an online medium to study and to find out how to sort of navigate an online space for many children is new, it's complicated, but they are able to engage with these occupations. But all of this also is happening in a context which is larger, that is around us, that many of these communities, families, individuals, and children that we work with, they already had their pre-existing challenges. Maybe disability, maybe the context they were in, maybe mental health issues. So all of that was existing, and now there are new challenges to add to it. And then there is a broader context again in which it is happening, which is fear of death. A common thing that is experienced by many, many of us and all of the people that we work with because of the situation we are in right now. Uncertainty about what's going to happen next, what is happening with COVID-19 situation. Will we ever be able to go out of this lockdown? Will we get infected? Will it come to our area? So many questions in that's constantly running around us and not having any fixed answers to this. This is happening also in a context of increasing rate of infection that we're constantly seeing in our country and around the world. We are also responding to a situation where we don't know how many days the lockdown is going to be. It continues to be this way. We have no idea when will this end. And for many, many people, their workspaces have been shut down. The occupation that they used to engage and preferred, one of them is completely shut down, leading to economical crisis. And the existing norms and biases of class, gender, caste, that participation in the time of COVID is also not free of occupational injustice, of how it's been divided according to class, caste, gender, and many, many other those biases that marginalize people. So imagine now that these people, communities, families, all of them are participating in their occupation in the context of all of this. What has that led to? Mental health effects. What kind of mental health effects? An increase in day-to-day distress and everyday distress, from morning waking up to not knowing what's going to happen to afternoon to evening. It's moments of trigger that was not there before, but it's there now in everybody's life. Anxiety, fearfulness of what's going to happen next, a sense of doom, you know, with the sense of grief that we are all experiencing with the number of death rates increasing, there's a sense of doom that what if this never ends? An increase in pre-existing mental health distress. For many, many individuals who are experiencing distress before, it has increased. The symptoms have increased. Loneliness, increased sadness, depression, self-harm, suicidal thoughts, and harmful substance use, abuse, engaging in occupations in an abusive way with alcohol and drugs, because that seems to become a coping method to respond to what's happening around. Now, how do we respond to all of this in the ways that it is happening? Let's think about what can we do, but before we also think about that, we need to take into consideration certain vulnerable groups, because this situation is going to affect some people more than others. Which are these vulnerable groups that we should take into special considerations? Children and adults with disabilities, geriatric population, women facing domestic violence, trans community, the LGBTQIA plus community, people affected by poverty, people living alone, and healthcare workers, including us. And I'm going to talk about some of them as we go along in this journey, about why do we need to specifically take care of this vulnerable group and take them into consideration while we are responding to the psychosocial impact. What can be possible occupational therapy goals in responding to psychosocial effects of COVID-19 pandemic? We can develop strategies for responding to immediate distress. One of the things that we really need to focus about is a short-term goal of how do we sort of respond to everyday, day-to-day distress and triggers people are having, or panic attacks people are having, or difficulty in participating and engaging in their everyday occupations, to figure out ways to participate in preferred occupations that people were able to do before the lockdown and now they are finding harder to do it, to discover and rediscover new occupations for people. Also to think about how do we collate information, because there has been such an information fatigue from all sources, news channels, social media. As occupational therapists, what can be our responsibility to collate information that's evidence-based and then disseminate it? Creating support networks, I'll speak about that as we go along, and preparing for transition after the lockdown ends. These can be six of our goals, possible goals that we can think of as we are responding to this situation. Let's look at the first one. Developing immediate strategies, and one of the best things to start with is think about calming strategies. How do we help people develop on their everyday basis some strategies that can help them to get through everyday distress and anxiety? Because there's a fear that if this distress continues to grow on an everyday basis, it can turn into an anxiety and panic attack and dysfunctionality to participate in any occupation. So how do we help people to develop calming strategies? One of the methods is to think about breathing exercises and meditation. Meditation is a skill that uses our natural ability to focus and be absorbed in experiences to help feel better in some way. It helps us develop better sense of control over how we feel. And it really helps us to think that we are the boss of our own bodies. We are in some sense of control over our feelings. And I'm going to take you to a website called Imagi Action by Stanford. It's freely available online, and it's a great resource to use with adults, with children, with any group of population. You can see on your screen right now, it talks about these little boxes which says, I want to be more relaxed. I want to feel okay not knowing exactly what will happen next. I want to be more in control of my feelings. So all these boxes are different things that people want or they're feeling. And what we can do is we can give this website link to people and they can use it. When they click here, it starts playing a recording. And you can use your earphones here. And as it starts playing recording, it gives you instructions and starts helping you to be more relaxed. And as well, it takes you in a meditative stance or a meditative position. We're going to practice it. Let's do it. Let's practice it together. So let's practice. What I would like you to do, wherever you are, to find a comfortable place for yourself. If you're sitting, it would be great to find a place where your feet are much more relaxed and touching the ground. To close your eyes, if you're comfortable. If you're not comfortable in closing your eyes, then you can look down with your eyes. And as you're doing that, start focusing on your breathing. As you breathe in, you will notice that the air is going through your nose. And as you breathe out, you'll notice that the air is going out of your mouth. It seems simple, right? But I would like you to focus on your breathing as it goes along. You're breathing in through your nose and you're breathing out through your mouth. Notice the flow of the air. As you're noticing the flow of the air, I want you all to think about of this air as a white light. As a white, shining, bright, fluidy light, which is entering through your nose into your body. As you breathe in, this white light enters your body. And as you're breathing in, start noticing that this white light is filling your lungs, the base of your chest. And as you breathe in, it starts filling your chest and moves upwards. As you breathe in and it starts moving upwards, you notice that it is moving towards your shoulders, filling your chest with white, bright light. And from your shoulders, now it's moving towards your arms, towards your elbows, towards your forearms, towards your wrists, your hand, your fingers, the tip of your fingers, and your thumb. This white light is now in your entire hand and starts moving below your chest into your abdomen. Starts filling your abdomen slowly, steadily moving towards your hips and as it starts moving towards your hips, it completes, it fills your back with white shiny light. Now this white shiny light moves towards your thighs, towards your knees, towards your calf muscles, your ankle, your feet, your toes. Now your complete legs are filled with the white light. Now I want to tell you to think about how this white light starts moving above your chest into your neck, into your mouth, your cheeks, your nose, your ears, your eyes, your forehead, your head, and the top of your head, and the back of your head. Now your complete body is filled with this white light. Now as your body is filled with this white light, I want you to start thinking of a place where you have felt emotionally safe, where you feel protected. It can be any place. It can be a place from your house, in a particular corner of the room or your bed. It can be with somebody who makes you feel safe. It can be a place that you have traveled to. It can be a library between books. It can be any of these places, or a place that you imagine in your life, might not be even real, or a place that you have seen in a picture book. I want you to go to this place. And as you're being in this place, I want you to look around and notice what's around you. The smells, the vision, what can you see around you? Are there people around you? Are there things around you? What's the temperature like in this place? I want you to spend some time in this place and know that this is a safe place that you can always come back to when the distress comes to you. At any point of time, whenever you feel like, you can open your eyes and come back from this place. I'll count from 1 to 10, from 10 to 1, and at 1, you can open your eyes. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hope you had a good experience. And this is a way that you can help, one of the ways that we can help people to go and discover safe places to go when the body feels worried or there is distress and anxiety. These are techniques that can help people to relax. And then if they practice this on an everyday basis, it becomes much more easier to go to these safe places and build safe emotional places for people. So you can try this out and share the same instructions, and you can try different kinds of instructions to discover more safe spaces for people. The other thing that we can do is that we can believe that people are always responding and they have lots of skills with them to respond to this distress, which might not be visible to them. And we often get into giving them solutions, but rather than giving them solutions, before that, we can if we believe that they're always responding to the distress, anxiety, and any kind of psychosocial impact, then I would like to ask them, what are some of the ways in the past have you responded to distress, uncertainty, and anxiety that has been helpful to you? And people will always tell you so many strategies, like they will tell you they watch television, they will start talking to somebody, they go to walk, they stop. They will tell you different kinds of ways. And what I usually do is make a list of all that they say, and then I ask them, how did you learn that? Can you tell me more about this? So try to take more history of these skills and make them richer and more conscious. And then I tell them to use them as a strategy for the following week, which might be helpful. It also makes them feel that they have skills and helps them have some sense of agency or control over the situation. The other thing that we can do is help people access and share updated evidence-based information on COVID-19. Right now, the psychosocial impact is also caused because of news that is given to people, the kind of news and fake news or news that is not evidence-based, rumors that are being spread about COVID-19 are impacting psychosocial situations of people and mental health of people in much more stronger ways that we don't imagine it to be. So it becomes our responsibility of helping communities, families, and individuals access this information in an updated evidence base. So let's look for information of what is WHO sharing, what is AOTA sharing, what is national bodies of health sharing, and collate them together and help people have this information, because that will have a major impact on people's mental health also. Requesting or helping people take breaks from social media, news channels, and newspapers. One of the key factors that's causing impact mental health distress is news. It's media, is information fatigue, all kinds of information coming to people. So helping people to take breaks, one of the major turning points in can be helping people develop this behavior to take break from news channels. And to assure them and to constantly keep on saying that it's okay to feel this way and that they are not alone in this. Many a times the feeling of distress increases because people feel, am I the only one who's reacting like this? We do not have a culture to speak about mental health needs, and hence people feel they're alone in this. So it's important to keep on telling people that it's okay to feel this way. Everybody is responding to this pandemic and all of us are affected by this, and distress is almost pretty much normal to all of us. And it's helpful for people to know that. Help develop routines to people. There has been a massive disruption in routine life, a regular life of people. And helping them develop routines, making timetables with them, helping them develop occupations that they can engage with, getting them to see what they can plan for the week ahead will be a great help to reduce the distress and develop predictability of what's going to happen next in people's life. How do we discover and rediscover new occupations? What do I mean by that? Learning new occupation that someone wanted to learn for a long time. Many people say, oh, I didn't have time to do that. I didn't have time to do that. Now, a lot of people have a lot of time in hand and they don't know what to do with it. When that's the situation, we can help people learn new occupations that they wanted to learn. I'm working with a client who's discovering their love to knit sweaters, knit little shawls, little crochet. That they are doing, and we are together sort of learning how to do that. It's been helpful for them because it's a repetitive task to keep their distress and worry and anxiety in control. Doing those occupations that are pleasurable, many people are discovering their love for cooking these days and they find it pleasurable. Many people are discovering their love for gardening or spending time watching movies. So discovering occupations that are pleasurable for people, doing occupations that involve other people, doing things together, like family game nights, playing games online, a craft or a food project together. I'm working with a couple who are, starting to work on a craft project together. And every week they set up a task for themselves where they together work on doing some kind of craft work like origami. So in a week they will do 10 different kinds of origami together. And it's become a way to develop to doing things together and supporting each other in this process of lockdown. Journaling, audio or video documenting projects, craft books to document stories of quarantine time. Many people are talking about how this has never happened in their lifetime and that they would like to tell these stories of what was it like to be in quarantine to their future generation. Such an interesting project and an occupation to discover. And they can use different ways like journaling, audio and video documenting. There's a adult I work with. They're doing everyday video documentation, like every day in the night for like 10 minutes. They talk about how their day was in front of a video camera. The other key thing that we can all do is start support groups, online virtual support groups or WhatsApp groups, which are not controlled, like facilitated by the occupational therapist. Why support groups? Because research has shown multiple times that support groups, when cultural norms and gender stereotypes make it hard to access services. And in the present situation, access to services is really hard. Also, the feeling of loneliness is really strong. Am I the only one who's feeling like this? In to respond to such situations, support groups come really handy. I run a weekly support group for caregivers of children with disabilities. And what we do in this support group is come together and talk about what the week has been like. You know, some parents will talk about how it's really hard. Mothers will talk about how they have to take care of everything in the house, cook, clean, take care of the child and things like that. And then they come together, share, they know that they are not. Then the other mother says, yes, I'm also feeling like this. And then I ask, how are you responding to this? What are some of the ways you're trying to figure your way out of this? And they will say, oh, you know, for 10 minutes, I sit and drink tea on my own. Just lock the room and sit for 10 minutes. That helps me a lot. And then the other mother talks about the same thing. We come together and sometimes play antakshari, sing songs. So it's a fun place to be, also a place where they can be vulnerable and share with each other what's happening in their life. So starting support groups is a great idea. Develop information for dissemination. When I use the word develop, I mean, as occupational therapists, we can develop pamphlets, newsletters, videos, activity books, and strategies, which can be then disseminated across groups of people who we are working with, and also through different spaces in public health systems. These two are a great examples. Like this one is developed by a group of children. It's called What to Do at Home During Times of Quarantine, a guidebook for adults by children. So children are telling adults what they should do. It's a fun one. You can access it in this in the website. And this one is one that's made by the UNICEF, which talks about COVID-19 parenting. There are many that UNICEF has made. They're really simple ones, nice ones. I'm working with a team to develop a resource material for children, like what can children do when worry and anxiety comes to them in times of the lockdown? How can they respond to them? So we are interviewing like 20 children and asking them, how are they doing this? We are taking all these strategies they are giving us and turning them into beautiful illustrations and storybooks. And then once it is created, we are going to sort of disseminate it to a group of, you know, children, families, and use it as a way to respond. So as occupational therapists, one of the things that we can do is develop these informations, like develop a pamphlet on what are pleasurable occupations that people can engage in, would be a great idea for people to start thinking about. We need to focus on certain vulnerable groups, and the first one I want to talk about is caregivers of children with disabilities. Why caregivers of children with disabilities? Because they're constantly feeling burdened by the idea that now, you know, they're at home, they have to take care of their children with disabilities, they have to take care of the family, cook, clean, and all of those things that people have to do, especially women in the house. So to make sure to tell them that it's okay to feel the way they are feeling, that a lot of caregivers are feeling like this, they will be feeling of being burnt out due to the increased workload. And we need to be careful of that, because burnt out leads to frustration, anger, and sometimes also responses that they're not happy of when they do things to their own children. So helping them take care of the burnout. How do we do that? We help them develop self-care strategies, you know, to take care of themselves, to take some moment of the time for themselves. What are asking them questions like, what are some of the things you love to do on an everyday basis? And it can be as little as listening to songs on mobile, you know, while they're drinking tea or while they're having a bath, or just when before going to sleep in the night, having some time for themselves. It's okay for them to not use this time to teach new things to their children. You know, as occupational therapists, we often train parents to sort of become their child's therapists, but this is not the time where they have to do a lot of new things, because they're burdened by many, many other things. So it's okay if some of them decide not to teach new things, to assure that if there is no medical condition which will regress their child, that the absence of them not doing any new things is not going to regress their child in any ways. Remind them to take break from parenting. It's a very, very important thing. And as professionals, when we say these things to parents and caregivers, they acknowledge it and they validate it, that they need a break from parenting. Start a support group for caregivers to meet each other, like I said in the slide before. For children with disabilities and children in general, listen to them. They have many questions. They are noticing what's happening around them, you know, sudden lockdown, change in the routine. They are not empty vessels who don't understand. So we need to answer to them in the best way possible we can. And some of the children have questions like, does our city have a fever, Mama? Is our city sick? Why does everyone look so sad? Why do people look angry and upset? Why don't I see smiling faces anymore? These are some of the many questions children have right now. How can we respond to them? Children understand things best when they're told to them in story form. And there are some beautiful resource material available there out for us to use, like this one called Something Strange Happened in My City, a social story about coronavirus pandemic for children. There's another one which many authors, children's authors, Indian authors came together to write, called The Novel Coronavirus, We Can Stay Safe. Each of these characters tell a different story of how to stay safe in times of corona. And there's another beautiful book done by a doctor, Dr. Sushma Khurde, which is Fight with Corona. It's a beautiful book drawn by children talking about how coronavirus can be fought, and children can do this together. So telling stories to children, being more specific, being concise in information, helps them to know what they need to know about the situation. Help children develop social-emotional language to express what they're feeling. Many times children do not have a social-emotional language to tell what they're feeling. They're all feeling anxiety and distress as we are feeling it. That they are not immune to this, but sometimes they might not have the language to express this. So we can help them develop this language, and books can be a great way to scaffold this. There's a book called Ruby's Worry, which talks about Ruby and a little thing called worry, which comes to her life and makes her feel worried. I often ask children to draw their own worries and what they look like, and then they start drawing worry after telling this story. And when they draw the vari, I ask them to make their own book where the vari comes at different point of time and makes them feel and think about thoughts that are not helpful. And it's a great way to help children develop socio-emotional language. There are other ways to do this, helping them write a diary. This is available. It's called My Lockdown Diary. And it has different pages like this one, Why a Lockdown Diary? Even though the world just became pretty different, there's still a lot to appreciate. This is for older kids, for teenagers, and even for adults to use to be able to develop this space to express what they're feeling and thinking. Help children develop occupations related to leisure. Example, an online leisure club, read aloud story time, art and craft sessions. We run this thing called the Fun Club, which is an online medium used on Zoom, where a lot of children come together and we do story readings for them. We do craft together. We do some dance together. We do some exercises together. It's a 1 hour session every Saturday and Wednesday. In the next week, we are doing like a summer club for children. So there are many ways to engage children and develop leisure in these times. It's also a time for many, many schools to have summer holidays. And this is the time children really enjoy going out. But it seems that's not possible, but we can create that space online for children. We can even use WhatsApp video call to run a group with 4 kids or 6 kids together. So it need not be a lot of children. It can be 2 or 3 children together too. The other vulnerable group of people we need to consider is women responding to domestic violence. The Ministry of Health has brought up this information that there has been a rise in the episode of domestic violence by 2-fold during the quarantine. Women do not have any other space to go but stay home, and which has increased the rate of domestic violence on them. We need to be sort of aware of this, and people, occupational therapists who are working with women can respond to this in many ways. And one of some of the ways is to access the local network of social workers and one-stop centers. One-stop centers are where women can go directly if the domestic violence is a lot and they cannot take. They have shelters there for women and social workers who can help them find those spaces. Provide telephonic or online counseling support to these women as we work with them. And safety becomes one of the key priorities for these women, to help them know what safety looks like for them and to keep on checking with them, are they safe or not? And if they are not, then to access the network of social workers to respond to this situation. The queer community, the LGBTQI community, is another vulnerable group of people that we need to take into consideration. Why? Because many of them are now forced to live with their families that are often abusive and not accepting of their queer identities in ways that the family also doesn't understand, which has a lot of impact on their mental health. Also, due to lockdown, there is restricted access to those spaces that queer people feel safe. You know, those are affirmative of their identity. And hence, we need to sort of create these spaces for them. All of those above strategies apply to everybody that we discussed previously. But support groups become key important. Link one queer person to another queer person if you know of, to bring them together to support each other in this journey, connecting them with mental health workers who specialize in queer mental health support. If you feel you're not equipped with this, that's completely okay, but to connect them with other mental health workers, but also help them to have all the other strategies we know as occupational therapists. Geriatric population is also one of the most vulnerable population in COVID-19. One of the key factors, because most elderly are aware that they are the most vulnerable to get infected because of the COVID-19. And they're constantly watching news that heightens their anxiety. So all of the above strategies apply to them most, and to look out for people, the older population. And specific strategies involved is to create safe emotional spaces for them, to to involve them in decision making and household chores if that was not happening before, and to sensitize the caregivers around them that geriatric population is a unique mental health need which we need to address, especially in the time like this. They might often not express, they might often be angry and frustrated, but that might be because all of this that's happening to them right now. I just wanted to share this thing that has been really helpful to work with vulnerable population and also with individuals who are living alone in their houses right now and are in a lockdown or quarantine. Many young people in metro cities live alone. Many other people who don't live with their families. We need to create sources for them, and this has been a very helpful activity called Pod Mapping. It's developed by a group of people called Bay Area Transformative Justice Collective. And what is a pod mapping? A pod is like a resource, you know, a place from where you can access support. They define pod as your pod is made up of people that you would call on if violence, harm, or abuse happened to you, or people that you would call on if you wanted support in taking accountability for violence, harm, or abuse that you have done, or if you witnessed violence, or if someone you care about was being violent or being abused. But this pod can also be used right now to derive support in terms of supporting your mental health due to COVID-19 situation when you're alone. How do you do it? If you go on this website, which the link will be on the AOTA website, you'll find these worksheets. You know, these are pod mapping worksheets. I did one for myself. So you on the center gray circle, you put the name of the client or whoever there is, and then ask them to think about those communities or resources or people that they will immediately reach out to or are easy reach out to or are assured that they will be there for them when help is needed. So the immediate black circle around is black circles are those group of people. Like I wrote my sister, my best friend, my neighbors, and Saad, who's a friend, but he's a doctor. So I call him every time I feel that something I'm feeling wrong about my body, or I have a client who is feeling weird about themselves, you know, about are they infected or not? Is this symptoms of COVID or they have anxiety? I call him to check what can I do. And then the outer circle are of those people who you think can be helpful, but are a bit movable. You're not sure about them. And then the outermost circle can be of other larger communities. Like I wrote, my organization that I work with can be another resource, or a support group that I go to might be another resource that may be helpful for me. So this is a pod mapping. It really helps people to develop a sense of control over their own situation and know that they are not alone and they have all these resources. Many a time in situations like this, it's very common to feel lonely and to know that you don't have anybody to help you. But an exercise like this can help people to know that they have a support system around them and has been very helpful in my work with adults and people and caregivers and families. At last, I just want to say that as occupational therapists and all healthcare workers, what we are doing in these times, caring for others, care work is real work. You know, often it is seen, you're just caring for others. This is what you have to do. But it is labor. It is work that we are doing. All these strategies apply to us as occupational therapists too. We need to do them for ourselves. We need to take care of ourselves. It's happening to everybody, which means it's happening to all of us too at the same time. Our mental health also needs to be taken into consideration, and we need to take care of ourselves too. So let's not put our mental health at the second part of here. Thank you so much for being with me. And I just want to end this talk with a book that I have been reading. In that, there's a page which says, "What's the best thing you have learned about storms?" The horse says that the end, said the horse. So we will get through this together. Thank you so much. These are my references, and I'll put the resources alongside. Thank you so much.